S&P 4600 resistance holds. Nasdaq futures hold a critical level. Microsoft earnings are out and the stock is down. Google's up 8% after hours. Snap continuing its tradition of being a dumpster fire is down 20%. TDOC up close to 10% after hours. A bank merger that led to 45% swings intraday. What drove Intel's buying in the middle of the day? We have a ton to go over. Let's get to it. Hey, everybody. Welcome back. You can see this real clear. We're still not through that 46.31, which is really the top of the level here. That's our peak from back in March of 22. We obviously want to clear that. And we just really haven't done that yet. But I think that that's just a matter of time, quite frankly. The fact that you can't even get down and make a lower low. And now we're just seeing it start to ride that level and really work this off. So we're not really seeing it fall apart very much, and we still have these higher lows all over the place. It's very difficult to look at this and say, oh, we have a problem. People will point to the volume. It's the summertime. It's nothing new that volume drops off. You can even see back here, very similar, where you'd have these lulls, and then you'd come into the next season, let's call it, where you start picking up in August, September, and you go from there. Now, what do we want to know for tomorrow about the S&P? What is going to be important that we have to pay attention to? What key levels? Now, tomorrow will be extremely volatile. First levels we want to talk about is obviously where are we going to see some kind of support. I would mark 4,500. Pretty obvious there that there's been some support. You'd come in there and you'd say that 4,530 level. There may be some support in there. And as we drill into this on the hourly, you can see that 4,558. We'll call it 4,560 just to make the math simple. And then you want to just watch that higher high. I do think that, you know, on a dovish conference call, I do think that Powell could drive the market tomorrow. We know they're going to raise rates. If they don't raise rates, we're going to go higher, period. But I would watch that level. If we can get through that 4605, that would be great. And that would propel us higher. I think it's really going to come down to the call. I expect them to be dovish, but you never know how this is going to go. But I would just take a screenshot of those levels. Now, Nasdaq futures came down and you just held in here, which is pretty fascinating. You're not really seeing any kind of pullback here at all. We've had this one really bad day where everybody was out. Oh, the bears are out again telling you, see, I told you so. We're definitely going to go lower. You're not real far off the recent highs, guys. And you start really looking up here and putting the context and saying, well, you're 6% off all-time highs, and you're not even really pulling back. It's very hard to get bearish looking at this chart and the strength that you're seeing here. This was your first test, and you held it, and you're aiming for this now. And I don't see any reason that you're not going to get there. We're going to go through some earnings tonight and some of these things that are going on out there that are very clear that we're probably going to continue to push. I think it's very clear, but we'll get to it. We're always due for a pullback when you're this high and you don't have some kind of base. What you really want to see, candidly, is this. And we're not seeing it yet, but it's out there. Where you shoot up and then you come back down and then you base for a period of time. We're just not seeing anything like that. We're not seeing anything like that at all. And I would prefer to see something like that, but what I prefer and what's happening are two different things. You're hardly pulling back. And that talks about the strength of the market. Even some of these leaders that are out there, and we're going to get into them, we're not seeing any significant pullback whatsoever. We're seeing mergers that are happening that are driving banking stocks up to the roof tonight. We're going to go through a couple of those because these mergers, they're just so, and the cost cutting is going to be huge, but what you're starting to see is you're just seeing, you can't even get to support levels. And that's a really good sign for the market. Now, you never know with the Fed and you never know with earnings. You're going to want to watch that 15,490 level. I'd pay attention to that tomorrow. And you stopped here again. So we always want to pay attention to levels like that. Why are we stopping right there? I don't have an answer for you. I can say that we can take that level and we can draw that straight across, and you can denote a couple areas here where it was resistance comes down, test support cracks. This is a key area as well, this 15.7. We seem to have gotten through it. I would watch both of those tomorrow. You can all see how you broke this DTL. But then you would just want to look for these control bars and see if they're going to walk you up, or how that's going to go. Now, if you come straight across and we just drop that right there, you can see that 15.869 would be an area that you'd want to pay attention to. And if you just took the top of this wick and just see rejection city up here, if you just use that and just realize you have rejections up here, you're around that 16.36 number. somewhere in there. So these would be the numbers that I would look at. If we crack this 15,489, that's a pretty long way down. You really don't have much. You'd have to start looking at some of these levels that really haven't been tested like these levels have, which makes them more susceptible to pullbacks till you got to something like this, which gets you to that 15.3 level. And then we kind of go from there. If it was to get ugly, they would be the levels that I would use. On the breakout, this is where I would be. I think it's really telling exactly what's happening here, where you're just staying in this range. I mean, you really have not moved for a period of time since last Thursday. You've been in this trading range here, and I don't see that changing. Now, we have a ton of names to go over. The best way to do this is to look at what the earnings and the revenues are, and then look at the key levels and how we're acting after hours. That's how I can add the most value. Comment below if you want to see it done another way or if you have a better way of doing it. I'm always open to feedback, but there's a lot of names to get here, and I want to go through it all. And of course, you have the Fed tomorrow. That's why we spent time on those levels. You beat. You hardly beat on the earnings front. They're not really moving. It's not a very cohesive, in my opinion, it's not very cohesive what they're putting out. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean, after hours, when you read this report and you read their plan and what they're looking for, it's not cohesive. You're seeing some amount of confusion here. Now, whether that confusion continues, because this is at the time of the conference call, we haven't seen the conference call yet, I don't know. I will say that you've been in this range, this 5-minute range, the entire time. Now, do you form that H or do you break out? I don't have an answer for you. The only thing I would do is I would watch these key levels tomorrow and see how you act. If you start taking out that lower low of 354 or 345 rather, if you start taking this out, it's definitely something I'd pay attention to. I would definitely be paying attention to those areas. Not so much in here. You can see it dropping a little bit here. Not so much running here. You can watch that and how you're hitting in there. But if I take out the low of the previous day, that's something I'd want to watch. And then that leaves me very susceptible down here. I'd want to pay attention to that. I'd want to see how this plays out. It was good. It wasn't great. I want to see what they say on the conference call, and I have to get this out before the conference call because they go on for a while. Google was just an absolute gem of a call. It was one of those calls you haven't seen from them in a very long period of time, but just stellar. Now, I don't know really what else to say about it, but it was just stellar across the board. Beat on revenue, beat on earnings, outlined a complete cohesive strategy for what they're doing with AI, how they're embedding AI throughout their entire business model. And if we drill into this and we look at these levels, this was something we were actually trading after hours in the room. And you look at these levels and you look at how they play out, it is very, very clear what's going on here. Very clear what's going on here and what to do with it. In my opinion, I would be focused on Google tomorrow over Microsoft. I think you're going to see a lot of people wanting to be involved with this particular name, and I would want to see how this plays itself out. Let's watch this, and we'll watch it very, very closely tomorrow, and I'd watch these levels I put here. When you have these little breakouts here and these orbs, you want to watch those after hours, and then you can see how we're acting right here. But we're acting great, and there's very little to do or to say about it, and this is probably going to be the call for tomorrow. You can see where those levels would fit up here if we take this out. Let me throw this into a weekly. You can just see where you're fitting into. Now, what's nice about this, let's just say we open at that 130 level. It's getting you to the pinnacle right here where you started to crack. It's starting to get you up in here and working off, and that's really what you want to see. That's the kind of stuff that we can start turning us around. You're coming out of this weekly flag, and you're breaking out. We'll go from there. Now, obviously, the Fed is going to lean on stocks tomorrow, and their comments will affect stocks. But when you start drilling into the earnings, it's very hard to look at this call and their statement, which was extremely cohesive, which was very different than what Microsoft put out, outlining what they're going to do going forward. It represents itself very nicely, and I would expect this to be around and see a lot of institutional sponsorship tomorrow. We talked about this earlier in the week, Snap, and the one thing I try to do is I try to link all these videos together. Now, if you look at this particular video that we did about a couple days ago on this and saying that, you know, what does the stock do? And before I even show you what the moving average is, just it's really clear. I mean, gap down, dumpster fire. They're all over the place, guys. You know, you really shouldn't be shocked that this is gapping down 20%, but nonetheless, it's not even the revenue and the earnings. It's the fact that their growth is just stagnant. No one's really using the platform. It'll probably stay around, but it's just not going to be a dominant feature. It just really is not going to be dominant. And they had a nice window there where they could have been a TikTok model, and they just chose not to do it for whatever reason. And they were the perfect app to be like that, because that's how they were set up. But they chose not to do it, and this is where you're at. So you've been in this trading range. I fully expect that you can come back down here into the low nines and hold in there. The reason that you're down is because of their subscriber growth. It was not great. What you don't want to see, and what I want to get to, is you really don't want to start closing below that 55. And that's exactly what you're going to do. You're going to close below that 55. If we go in here, just take a second, and we click these others off, and we just look at the 55. Every single time you start breaking below that 55, you wind up just trending lower. You know, when you hold it, you're good. You trend lower. That one held a little bit. That's the only one really that held, and you can just see how we respect it. So the idea that we're going to gap below that 55 is worth noting for everybody tomorrow, and definitely something that I would be paying attention to. I can't stress enough, you know, I don't see somebody coming in to buy the company the way he structured his shares. I just think it's going to be one of these kind of legacy things that bounces around, and it is what it is. I just don't see much more coming out of it. But to me, I think it just slowly dwindles away into a utility more than anything else. Now, PacWest was all over the map today. You have earnings. The earnings were okay. The issue is that they look like they weren't going to make it. People got a little concerned. I thought that they would be at risk, but they merged, and their merger is driving the stock price higher. The merger is being done at 0.66 shares, meaning you can see how it's trading at 10:30. And let's get into this. You can see when we opened in here, how the stock acted after the merger. Once it was announced that they were going to merge, everybody thought that this was going to be like an FRC, a First Republic, or a Credit Suisse, where there was going to be zero equity. And quite frankly, you have no idea. No one has any idea what this merger was going to look like. They're not wrong in thinking that. It very well could have done that. You got whipsaw today. There's very little to say about it. That's part of the game. Now you can see how you're holding in here. Came right to this level. But really, it's about BANC now. And they're the ones that are buying. What you really do is you just take the price of BANC. And you take that price, you times it by 0.66. And that'll tell you roughly where your stock should be on PACW. Obviously, the merger is going to have zero problems going through. They want these mergers to go through to shore up these banks. BANC didn't have the greatest earnings in the world, but once these two companies merge, the synergies will be there. It'll make the deal accretive, which means that they will make more money. People really aren't paying attention to the fact that they missed revs, because the earnings are going to be up substantially based upon this merger, and that's why they're both trading up. I wouldn't sleep on these tomorrow. I think these are excellent trading vehicles. And they're definitely names that I've been playing in all day. And I bought this as soon as it reopened after hours and did quite well with it. You know, very little to say here, guys. I'd be playing with these. And I'm trying to focus on the names during earnings a little bit more. You can comment on that below. I will read the comments. I do want to get into Intel and what they did, because I think it's pertinent. Now, if we take a look here, you're going to see a huge spike right here when I drill into this. Now, what happened here? Well, they went through all their inventories and they said, okay, we're going to raise prices based upon what we're seeing in the inventories and the restructuring model. As soon as they did this and they said, we're going to restructure, you're looking at, they're going to increase prices by single digits to 20%. And when we saw that, we also saw some of these names. If you take a look at the timing of this, 215, 217, you started to see a little bit later, and you saw all the EV names start to kind of calculate it out and roll it in and start dropping the EV names down. It wasn't just one. It was really all of them started kind of coming in around that time. I think people they're reading too much into it, quite frankly, but it doesn't really matter. This is what happened. This sold off. I would watch this very, very carefully tomorrow. I think this has massive potential when people start getting into this and really start reading this and seeing how this goes. Now, tomorrow you have a ton of earnings coming out. If you're watching this today, the biggest one for tomorrow, to me, is just going to be Boeing and seeing how Boeing acts going into earnings. People really like the industrial space. I'd be watching that one for sure. And then after hours, Wednesday night after the Fed meeting, we'll cover these. But you have Meta tomorrow night. You have Chipotle. I know everyone loves the way I say that. You have Now. You have a lot of names here, guys. That's why tonight is really focused on the names more than anything else. I figured that that would be the most helpful. And again, I just want to really hammer this home. Google knocked it out of the park. Microsoft was confusing. It was not bad, but it was confusing. And maybe they'll fix that on the conference call. I don't have an answer to that because this is filmed before that call.